Hi, I'm Bill Olson. Welcome to another show, Free Speech Zone. We're going to continue today with parts three or two and three of the Thomas Drake interview. You know, one of the 9/11 whistleblowers that everybody says, well, how come if 9/11 was an inside job, how come nobody came forward and told about it? You mean besides the dozens and dozens and dozens that you haven't heard of? Yeah, well, those are the folks that are being held back by the media. But before we get into that, I want to digress a little bit. You know, I really like Bernie Sanders. However, you know, what I resent is that he's running as a Democrat. That eliminates Bernie Sanders. He's not in the election. That means that he's going to have to, well, first of all, nobody in the Democratic Party is going to let Bernie Sanders win unless it's to trick the voters into thinking they got something. But the bottom line will be the Democratic line, the name is on the top. You're not going to see a policy change, even if Bernie Sanders gets elected as a Democrat. So there are a couple of reasons why I don't like this. Because one, Bernie can't win as a Democrat. And two, he's going to have to endorse Hillary. That's part of the deal of running as a Democrat. He's going to have to kick back and say, okay, our best chances by going with Hillary. It's the false left-right paradigm. Which brings us to our first clip today, a real short one. Lionel, one of those few people that has a one-name familiarity. Lionel of Lionel Media, Lionel Nation. Go ahead and play this one about the false left-right paradigm.
It's Tuesday, August 11th. I'm Simone Del Rosario in Washington, D.C., and you're watching RT America. Well, 15 months from the general election, there's no escaping the political noise. From the left to the right, headlines featuring Hillary Clinton, Bernie Sanders, Jeb Bush, and Donald Trump, among a slew of others. But really, what's the difference? Legal and media analyst Lionel is joining me now. Lionel, you've spoken repeatedly of the illusion of the left-right paradigm. What exactly does that mean?
Well, this is going to shock our colleagues in mainstream media, but the left-right paradigm is an illusion, a fantasy, because Democrats and Republicans are two sides of the same coin. Now, Carol Quigley, who happened to be Bill Clinton's mentor at Georgetown, spoke of this in his masterpiece, Tragedy and Hope. And what he said was that you create this fiction that the left and right and Democrats and Republicans are in fact two different, and in every election cycle or two, you throw the bums out and shift the direction of the country, but there's no shift, there's no redirection, because they're the same.
So if your truth is truth, then what are Democrats and Republicans?
They're Yankees versus the Red Sox, the conservative versus the liberal, or its weird cousin, the progressive. It's Fox News versus MSNBC, the flag, God, family, and Reagan versus global warming, polar bears, abortion, and Hillary Clinton. Symbols and bumper sticker ideology, echo chamber chatter, giving the illusion that Democratic and Republican politicians reflect those differences. But you got to ask yourself, really, what do you notice that's different about Barack Obama versus George Bush?
Oh, I won't tackle that one, but always a pleasure talking to legal and media analyst Lionel of Lionel Media. Well, that does it for us for now. For more on the stories we covered, go to youtube.com/RT America and check out our website, rt.com/USA. You can also follow me on Twitter at Simone Reports. Question more.
Well, I can tell you what's different about Barack Obama and Bush. The brain dead people that still think that there's politics and that elections are real, they don't like Obama because he's black. That's the difference. Aside from that, they both kiss ass. Excuse me, but that's the way it is. Okay, we're going to go on to Thomas Drake, part two of five. And reality asserts itself with Paul Jay from the Real News Network. So let her rip.
and not revealing the NSA secretly.
On the Real News Network, I'm Paul Jay. We're going to continue our interview with Thomas Drake, whistleblower, former senior executive, I guess you could say, or officer at the NSA, and also someone who stuck his neck out. Very concerned about the role the NSA played, both in not preventing 9/11, which he says they could have, and not revealing the NSA secretly, developing a mass surveillance state, which he then helped to expose, and other things. So he's a man who stuck his neck out. Thanks for joining us. So in part one, we talked about how deliberate this process is. Welcome back to Reality Asserts Itself on the Real News Network. I'm Paul Jay. We're going to continue our interview with Thomas Drake, whistleblower, former senior executive, I guess you could say, or officer at the NSA, and also someone who stuck his neck out. Very concerned about the role the NSA played, both in not preventing 9/11, which he says they could have, and not revealing the NSA secretly, developing a mass surveillance state, which he then helped to expose, and other things. So he's a man who stuck his neck out. Thanks for joining us. So in part one, we talked about how deliberate this process is, and the question of how much of this is lack of prioritization. And by this, I mean the suppression, withholding of evidence that various intelligence agencies gathered prior to 9/11 that might have prevented 9/11. And you know, one of the things that is easiest to focus on, because there's other examples as well, but this one of these guys in San Diego, two guys that FBI know are there, CIA know are there, NSA know are there. And in a report or a public memorandum that you and some of your colleagues sent to President Obama in 2014 titled NSA Insiders Reveal What Went Wrong, in relating the NSA, the statement says this: was it a case of gross ineptitude on NSA's part, or was NSA deliberately withholding information linking al-Mihdhar to the known al-Qaeda base in Yemen? I mean, what you're suggesting, it could have been deliberate. What would it, why would they do it?
You have to understand, I want to come back to this, and something that's fully appreciated, because it's easy to say it was deliberate. It's easy to say they withheld it on purpose. It's easy to say they knew this and didn't share it. Counterterrorism NSA was not a priority at all. It just wasn't. The office that even dealt with it was a backwater office of about 20 people. I used to work extensively with them, particularly after 9/11. They themselves complained about all the reports that they had been issuing for years and years and years, largely in response to the Tenet memo, the systems brinkling red, all the way back to 1998, would continuously fall on deaf ears.
But the Clinton presidency took it seriously enough to appoint Richard Clark to essentially a cabinet-level position. I mean, that's taking terrorism seriously.
Well,
it's the Bush presidency that demotes him.
Yeah, because Cheney didn't trust Clark at all.
So why not replace him and have someone else at the cabinet level?
Because it gets in the way, and the potential that, you know, he may say something out of turn. They didn't trust him. So if you can't control, if you don't trust somebody, then obviously you don't believe you can control them.
And you suggested in the last segment that Cheney sets up his own back channels to get intelligence directly to him.
He basically created his all with all the key leaders and then some all the way down into the bowels of each agency.
So if the NSA isn't prioritizing terrorism, isn't that a decision not to prioritize it at a time when you're getting all this information saying there's such real threats?
Yeah, but you're also getting staggering amounts of information. You got to remember the part of the problem here was the glut of information. You were just getting flooded I remember later the FBI even talking about this with me, even prior to 9/11, just staggering amounts of information coming in. How do you sort through it all? How do you make sense of it all? This is the great challenge NSA faced, one of the reasons I was hired. How do you make sense in a massive stream of data, basically oceans of data? How do you find the drops that matter? But, and that was part of the challenge,
frankly. But Tenet says it's the highest priority facing the United States. So they've sifted through all this stuff, and they've come to the conclusion.
Saying it's a priority doesn't mean you're actually going to find what's of priority. That's part of the disconnect here. Saying it is, by virtue of what we knew at the time, but then actually finding those things to take action. Remember, intelligence fundamentally is about indications and warning. You have to have the indications, but then you have to report it as a warning. Those are tip-offs. Those are alerting people. But if you don't do that and the action's not taken, it doesn't matter if Tenet sits there all day hollering the sky is falling when it actually is. I can keep my head buried in the sand for a long, long time because nothing has happened yet.
Right. Well, except some stuff had happened.
Well, nothing had happened in the, quote-unquote, the homeland.
Well, they'd already attacked the World Trade Center, as you said in part one.
That was sort of forgotten.
I'm going to keep after you here.
No, that's okay. No, it's part of the contradiction.
Because that's what I'm hearing from you is this contradiction that
it's a fundamental
we can follow one line of conversation and you'll say, they let it happen. And then another line of conversation.
It was convenient to let it happen, knowing something would happen. Why would you actually want to make an effort to prevent it? Because by letting it happen, you would have your excuse. Cheney had made it clear, right? Crystal clear. What he wanted to do was reestablish the authority of the president.
And in Project for New American Century, they actually come out and say, you know, all the things we should be doing in terms of asserting U.S. military then political power in this new post-Soviet era.
Yes.
We need a new Pearl Harbor because American public opinion has no taste for more war.
That's why I said it was convenient to allow the course of events, their due, and whatever would happen, knowing something would happen. Why would you want to stop it?
That's why I'm saying the deprioritization is not unconscious.
No, I would agree, it's not. But if you're at the NSA, you do have the dynamic of you're going to culturally not really, because it's not a priority. And remember, all this was a super close hold. The vast majority of NSA is not on the counterterrorism mission. They're doing all the traditional stuff.
Same thing. Colleen Rowley have interviewed, and maybe we'll link to her interviews so you can find them as we're doing this. She said in the interview, because I asked her a somewhat similar question, she said the FBI was specifically told don't prioritize terrorism by Cheney. There was actual instructions that this is not the priority of our administration, which is part of why she says they couldn't get the FBI's attention to really pay attention to what they had found in Minneapolis.
That still doesn't matter, though. I realize that's a huge factor in terms of saying it isn't, but you're obligated to under the Constitution to provide for the common defense. If you have information that rises to a level that says something is happening and it's going to be really bad, you got to share it. You got to bring in the key people. You got to take action to prevent it. That's the whole point. Now, I've said this before, that whole process was subverted by Cheney and company.
Okay.
So the system, what I'm saying, the system itself was essentially set aside. The secret channels were the ones that were utilized. And they knew much better than anybody else that something big was going to happen. They didn't actually know exact time or date. There's actually more than just passing evidence that they had wanted to do what ultimately happened much earlier. They just weren't able to make it all happen.
Yeah,
we know about all the test flights. We know about you have James Woods, who actually was interviewed, realizing that one of the many flights he took from the east to the west coast, he remembers certain people, right, of Middle Eastern descent who were on those airplanes, on those flights. It was clear that they had
James
spent
Woods
a long time,
is.
The actor. Yeah, they knew they had spent a long time working this out, making observations. testing how secure, insecure our system, our airline in particular, and the security mechanisms.
Now, one of the things that has come out of Bob Graham's joint congressional investigation is this famous 28 pages of their report, and essentially Graham has acknowledged, and there's been press reports, that what are in these 28 pages is the evidence they say, of direct Saudi role in financing and facilitating, and according to Graham, Saudi government role in financing and facilitating. If this is true, the NSA must be hearing this stuff. This is part of what the NSA must not be passing on. It's not just about the information in San Diego. They got to know about the whole Saudi connection.
Yeah, but that's political. That's geopolitics at the highest level. You're not going to counter the president when it comes to that. Or the vice president, for that matter. This is really serious stuff. You're talking at the heart of dark government, what I call the double government. This is the other government in action. You set it up in a way that, obviously, you're going to protect the Saudis. And yes, clearly the Saudis had a huge. Remember, most of the hijackers came from Saudi Arabia. Remember, I can look this gift horse right in the mouth and say what is so. But that's what most people don't want to do, because it opens up some really disturbing questions about power and who we are and who's in charge.
And when did you start asking yourself these particular kinds of questions?
Oh, early on in my life. Early on. Yeah. I, early on, because of experience I had, never trust anybody in any position of power or authority. Because they're usually up to no good, or they'll abuse their positions of power or authority. That's why I wear a Q. It's question everything, especially authority.
And why did you then work for so many years in the state, one form or another, in this dark state?
It was serving my country, and I'm in the system. People, there's a longer history. I actually blew the whistle when I was in the Air Force. I blew the whistle when I was a contractor. On a major program at NSA called Minstrel. Something the FBI reminded me of. It says, yeah, we know about your whistleblowing of Minstrel. It was supposed to modernize the voice processing, bring it into the modern era. So yes, it was serving my country, but you got to keep the secret government in check, because it tends to abuse itself. We have too many incidents. I mean, you go back to the Gulf of Tonkin, where you deliberately manipulated, actually created and framed the intelligence to make it look like the North Vietnamese had actually attacked when they hadn't. And of course, that was the excuse that Johnson needed to expand the war, right? What a disaster that was.
Nixon torpedoing the Johnson's negotiation with the North
Vietnamese.
That's
a whole other one.
If you're interested in that one, we have an interview about that where we actually play the tapes that the Johnson Library released, where he accused Nixon of acting like a traitor and said 50,000 more American boys' lives are going to be on your head. Nixon ignored him.
This is all history that burdens me, okay? This is why I try not to get too cynical about the human condition. I'm well aware of what happens in history. I'm well aware of secret agreements, both in World War I and World War II, that were triggered, right? Because, violated, and then things are unleashed, right? I mean, this is not pleasant stuff for people to look at. Most people don't want to look at the Pandora's box of history, because it's not pleasant. It just isn't. And so you have enormous power. Power is pathological when you start using it for other purposes. Power itself, Lord Acton's right, does tend to corrupt. It doesn't mean it always corrupts, but it tends to, because most people cannot resist the siren call of what it can do for you.
When you talk about disturbing dark questions and the heart of this dark state, do you think that's one of the reasons that what the NSA knew pre-9/11 more wasn't done on, because it leads to the Saudis, if Graham's commission's right?
In part it does, but they're also caught up at even the higher levels of the government. It's not just NSA, but NSA is a secret military intelligence agency. It was signed into being by virtue of a stroke of a pen by President Truman. It was never legislated into existence. It was secret. military intelligence. We gotta be real here about what that agency does. It's headed by now a four-star general. You know, that's a military order. That's a military rule. That's, you know, it's not led by a civilian. It reports up through the Department of Defense. Historically, now we got the DNI. NSA routinely broke U.S. laws even prior to the 1970s. That all came out. Much of it came out. Not all of it in the Church and Pike committees, even the Rockefeller Commission, right? But none of that, that's I could argue that NSA's broken the law for most of its history. It's, remember, it was foreign intelligence. You were designed to break, it didn't matter what the rules were or the laws of any respective country. You were gonna collect whatever you needed to collect for the purposes of national security. And national security is the purview of the president.
So again—
That's the national security state.
Why do you stay in it? And why then, why, it sounds to me like you could have had other opportunities to blow the whistle that might have put you in the same predicament. Now you do, but—
Yeah, but this is different.
Why?
You know, though the earlier ones were, you know, you're talking about just fraud and waste. This is a whole different matter. This is actual violations of the Constitution. Willful, deliberate violations.
Meaning mass surveillance.
Mass surveillance. Remember, I was on the very program in which we were helping the FBI. I one of myself and a colleague. We right after 9/11, we were tasked and all approved to help put together the affidavit information would go up before the secret court. That was the secret court called the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court under the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, passed in 1978 under the Carter administration, which in itself was a compromise. This is the means by which in secret, although you still have to meet Fourth Amendment probable cause thresholds to issue a warrant, although there were hot pursuit where you actually could pursue if the threat was that great, and but you still go back to the court for the warrant. Completely bypassing it. We were taken off that effort. When I confronted Marie McGinsey, she said they've gone with a different program. I knew when she told me that. This is in the first few weeks after 9/11 that we were way across the Rubicon. We were in a whole new vehicle. It wasn't just the wheels came off. We're in a whole new vehicle I did not recognize. It was an alien form of government. I didn't take the oath to defend an alien form of government.
And you think it gets created whole cloth just after 9/11?
No.
There's no pre-thinking here?
No, this goes all the way back to 1947. I could point to 47 as the epigenesis of the national security state.
So this is taking advantage of crises to establish things
sure
that
is.
Have been worked out.
Yes. And I'm well aware of other things that have, you know, happened in terms of emergency orders in case of national crises. Right?
For example?
COG, you know, continuity of government.
I'm well
aware of mechanisms that have been in place even during the Cold War,
continuity
which essentially would establish martial law, virtual martial law, and real martial law if necessary. This is all of this thinking, not just conceptual, but all the planning, the mindset, the view was already in place.
And isn't that kind of the whole point about how these people view the Constitution, that the Constitution can essentially be suspended whenever it's pragmatic to do so?
And you just, remember, I'm witnessing in secret the subversion of the Constitution. So what does that mean? They're setting it aside.
So how come, you're working with all your colleagues, how come you stick your neck out at this moment when it becomes so overt? It's been going on for years. And most people are saying to themselves, it's been going on for years. Why should I stick my neck out? This is all kind of going on during the Cold War. This is kind of just at a new scale. It's not brand new. But you stick your neck out and you say, no. Why?
I owed it to the people. I took the oath. I wasn't going to break the oath that I took. The oath mattered to me. It was the fourth time I had taken it. It mattered. And here's the president committing high crimes and misdemeanors as defined by the Constitution.
And how did it feel?
Suspending the Constitution because we had failed to provide under the preamble the common defense. Suspending the Constitution for all intents and purposes, willfully and deliberately. So the only thing left that I have is defend it. So I decided to keep defending it from within until I no longer could. That's when I went outside the system. And that's what got me in trouble.
And how did it feel that the president who got elected next, who's supposed to be the anti-Bush, is the one, President Obama, who actually is the one that targets you?
Obama knew about my case personally. Okay, I know that for a fact because he was confronted in the Oval Office when he was given a transparency award in secret. And everybody who was there, and I was, it was related to me, his body language said everything, where he actually leaned forward on the edge of his chair, basically saying, we just can't have these kind of leaks. You know. Can't damage national security of the United States. National security, as I have said, is the secret religion of the state. You don't question it. We'll excommunicate you.
You can't be president and question it.
That's
not
right.
Not and live.
Well, you know, that's a pretty strong statement you make. But he was given a silver platter in secret with all the goodies of presidential power. And if you're the new president and you look at that platter, you're not going to put it back in the drawer. You're going to keep it, right, out for use if you need to. Why would you take off the platter, the presidential power platter? Why would you take those items off? You know, you're the president after all.
Well, let's look at the other side of this. Here's what Michael Hayden said.
Somebody would come up to me and say, look, Hayden, here's the thing. This Snowden thing is going to be a nightmare for you guys for about 2 years. And when you get all done with it, what you're going to be required to do is that little 215 program about American telephony metadata. And by the way, you can still have access to it, but you got to go to the court and get access to it from the companies rather than keep it yourself. I go, and this is it after 2 years? Cool.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean.
Do you think he was actually acting for a foreign government?
So intelligence officers answer questions like that using inductive reasoning.
I hope so.
We go to,
no,
yeah.
Not information.
Intelligence. We go to data.
Yeah.
And then we're supposed to draw generalized conclusions from data. And I got no inductive trail that tells me Snowden was helped. On the other hand, if I go deductive on you, which is, this is what he did, how do I best explain it? I got my suspicions, but I'm not a deductive guy. I'm an inductive guy by profession, and therefore, I have no evidence.
But they're arguing the reason they're doing it is because there's real threats out there.
That's an end justifies a means. That's Machiavelli. We're doing this for your own good. Stand aside. We're the authority. We have the power. You don't.
So
that's not a constitutional republic.
Well, I think they would argue, if they were being honest, that you can't have a constitutional republic and defend the United States against its threats. That really is their argument.
That means that they consider the Constitution a suicide pact.
Or a convenient thing to have out there when you need it.
Well, you got to keep the masses, you know, some would say the sheeple, right, in line. And so, yes, we have the convenient veneer of a constitution under which we all, quote unquote, take an oath to support and defend, including Michael V. Hayden when he was a general and when he was director of CIA as a civilian, when he retired as a four-star. But all that doesn't matter. We have an existential crisis. As I was told, you don't understand, Mr. Drake. Exigent conditions apply. Emergency action is necessary to deal with the threat. It doesn't matter that we failed to protect people, protect the nation. We did not keep people out of harm's way. And that whole national security state apparatus, put into place formally in 1947 in the Cold War, just got transmuted into the 21st century with a new existential threat. And it was going to be decades, if not longer, that we would have to deal with it.
And is it possible to have or be the global hegemon? Is it possible to have the kind of foreign policy where there's military bases all over the world? Is it possible to have all the extra economic advantage that global military power gives you and still have a constitutional republic at home?
No, because the chickens always come home to roost. The very policy mechanism you apply in foreign adventures will come home to roost. The irony, of course, for me is that the United States became the petri dish for mass surveillance. That's what I became eyewitness to. That was exported overseas, as if mass surveillance was the answer. Remember, mass surveillance has far less to do with protecting people than it does to drive national security interests and protect national security interests.
And how do you define how do they define national security interests?
National security interests is what they define based on what needs to be protected for those who are in power and to protect the policies that they implement. It has far less to do with liberty and real security.
When I asked Larry Wilkerson this, and a somewhat similar story in many ways, you know, someone who joined the armed forces to fight in Vietnam, was in the Bush administration, and got completely disillusioned by it all. His answer was, in the final analysis, what kind of shook him is how banal the interest is in the end, because it's actually about money.
It's actually really... I can make a very powerful economic argument to this whole thing is just an enterprise.
Go ahead.
It makes people a whole lot of money, because that's partly what I was more than eyewitness to. Look, when I was going around, just giving an example, right after 9/11, the workforce knew we had failed the nation. People really took it hard, because that was our responsibility, was to provide for common events. We hadn't done that. So almost 3,000 people are murdered. So we're going around the campus. I'm with Marie McGinsky. Guess what? How is she explaining it? Marie McGinsky, the signals intelligence director, the person I reported to. Going around, very visible person, because it's the largest organization at NSA by far. It's the offensive side of NSA, not the defensive side. It's the core mission of NSA. And her explanation is that NSA was a gift. 9/11 was a gift to NSA. And then she said, we'll get all the money we want and then some. It was clear that this was not just the failure was now going to result in all kinds of money. And that's why during the 50th anniversary of NSA, which it took place in the fall of 2002, and I was there, I remember Hayden up on the dais receiving this big check, like the fake check Publishers Clearinghouse, right, that they used to have, and they made a big deal of it with the cameras rolling. You won $1 million. Let's just say there was a number, right? It was in the billions. And it was one of the then House staff managers, his name was Tim Sample, who was handing this check over to Hayden. And I clearly remember, although I could not hear the words, but it was clear just from I can sort of lip read. He was looking down at George Tenet, then pointing to the check, looking back to George, said, George, I got my money, George. Look, if you're at NSA and you're going to get all the money you want and then some, you really are. Billions and billions were poured, not just NSA, but throughout. CIA, FBI, you name it. This became a huge jobs program. I mean, the quickest way to become a millionaire was to start a small company, as many of my colleagues did. Hire 5 or 6 people, you're an instant millionaire.
Because you can sell these services to the NSA.
Yeah, and you can replicate them with the other agencies.
Okay, in the next segment of our interview, we'll talk about the controversy over what kind of program to use.
But it's one of the big elephants in the room. Look, I mean, you say war crisis profiteers. Why? What the heck? I'm not going to let this go to waste. And it doesn't matter that it's the national treasure of the United States. It doesn't matter if it's American taxpayer money. And of course, most all of this was being deficit funded anyways.
And
doesn't matter. This is for national security. We're going to get what we want.
And doesn't matter. This was really all preparation for the invasion of Iraq that might have cost a million Iraqis' lives.
The truth be told, they were looking for an excuse to invade Iraq before 9/11. They had it. That was the real priority in terms of what we would do militarily overseas.
From day one.
Yes, from day one.
The Bush administration.
Right. Other people forget as well is that NSA was circulating during the presidential transition team period, the PTT. Bush is elected, Clinton is still, he's president-elect, but he's not the president, he has not taken the oath. There was a memo that was circulated by NSA seeking relief on the probable cause standard of the Fourth Amendment. they are looking for ways to erode it significantly.
So if your highest foreign policy priority in reality from the very beginning is the invasion of Iraq, then it's not a big surprise you deprioritize terrorism, because heck, wouldn't that be a nice excuse for what our number one priority is?
And then conveniently link it, which was of course completely framed, that Iraq had something to do with 9/11. Yeah, had absolutely nothing to do with 9/11.
Okay, we're going to continue this discussion. Please join us for the continuation of Reality Asserts Itself on the Real News Network.
Okay, so now we're going to go pretty much right into the third part of this five-part show, and it'll take us right up to the end. So then next week we'll show you parts 4 and 5 and whatever else it takes to fill in. So see you then.
Welcome back to Reality Asserts Itself. I'm Paul Jay. We're on the Real News Network, and we're continuing our series of discussions with Thomas Drake. You'll find his biography just below here, and I've read it out all the other times, so I'm not going to do it again. But just quickly, Thomas worked at the NSA, was a whistleblower, was charged with espionage, eventually more or less beat the charges. You had to agree to, well, Thomas is here in the studio. First of all, thanks again. You agreed to plead to what would amount to a misdemeanor?
There's quite a story behind it in terms of how it all happened, but on my own terms, I pled out to a minor misdemeanor for exceeding authorized use of a computer under the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. With the proviso that they would drop all of the 10 felony counts from the indictment, and no fine and no jail time. So I had 1 year probation from the judge and 240 hours of community service, in which I ended up interviewing veterans from World War II to the present day.
So let's do the backstory, because you've said several times that it's hard not to get just extremely cynical, I guess, about America, about the world, about life. But to feel like you're getting so cynical, you must have kind of believed in it in the first place. So kind of go back in terms of, you grew up in a house, your father's military, right?
My father's a World War II veteran. He was a bombardier navigator, also flew missions
Same with mine.
He also flew missions in support of the OSS. He was the only man that got out of an airplane that went down in flames. He was behind the lines for 6 months. So he also lives with survivor's guilt.
And
he made the military, it's true, he was in the Strategic Air Command. So when the Air Force was created in 1947 as part of the National Security Act, he then rejoined the military with the newly created Air Force after he got his degree with the GI Bill.
So you were a military kid. You grew up in the culture of being...
Born in Louisiana, moved to England. He was an exchange officer of the Royal Air Force, moved back to Texas, where he retired in the early 60s. And I was a very young child growing up in Texas, a republic before it became a state, and then we moved to Vermont shortly after he retired.
And how would you describe the political culture of the House in terms of how they voted, what they believed in?
Well, he was...
Americanism, how important was that?
He was military. I mean, you serve your country, you support your country. He had spent a whole career, right? And the World War II veterans in particular, I mean, that was sort of like the last great war that mattered. Everything else since then has never been a war. In fact, that's the last time we even declared war. Congress declared war, which is the only branch of government that has the prerogative of doing so. But we haven't done that since World War II. So it was very much a very orderly, to the T, kind of a household. Father's a very difficult man to live with. You know, he had a lot of burdens that he carried himself, I think, just from his own history. That wasn't always easy dealing with him.
You grow up believing that America fights for truth, justice.
Well, I mean, I'm now living in New England, your daughter's American Revolution. I mean, Ethan Allen, the Green Mountain Boys, and it was a grand experiment. It was launched in 1789 when it was ratified. It took 2 years, but we now have a constitution. For all of its faults and foibles, that was this new form of government.
You become a teen, or you enter your teens, the Vietnam War is still on.
The Vietnam War is still on. I actually remember as a freshman seeing seniors burning their draft cards in the back parking lot.
What did you think of that?
Well, the Vietnam War at that point was you know, it was part of the social revolution, and it was clearly very negative. You know, it was a waste. It was.
But did you feel that at the time, and how did your father feel about it?
Well, my father actually, in that period, he was first for it, and then became quite disillusioned, and turned on the Vietnam War.
And what about you?
Yeah. Same with me. But see, I was the next generation. I was not part of the Vietnam generation. The Beatles are history for me. For me, it's Peter Frampton and Grand Funk and, you know, the Bee Gees a year later. So I graduated in 1975. We were actually the first year of the non-Vietnam generation.
And did you, you were old enough to attend some protests. Did you ever get engaged in that way?
Not then. That was all through television. That's how I saw it. I was not part of any protest during that time. I mean, in fact, those protests had taken place. That was all history for me. You have to remember, I was the bulk of the protests that you're talking about, right? I was 8, 9, 10, 11 years old, right? So it was all history.
Well, you're born in 57.
57.
So 67, you're 10. The war's certainly going on.
I was growing up on a farm in Vermont. Yeah, not unaware, and of course, in high school, obviously, those classes ahead of me were very much against the war and were very much against, you know, government abuse. And of course, you have to remember, I'm eyewitness. My civic awakening took place in the 70s, so I'm there with Ellsberg, the Pentagon Papers. You know, I'm seeing a young Hillary Rodham, who was actually serving on the House Impeachment Committee, drawing up articles of impeachment. The whole Watergate with Bernstein, you know, Woodward and Bernstein, extraordinary set of events, and then seeing a president of the United States resign their office. I mean, it's quite something.
And how much does that show?
All the abuses that came out from the Church and Pike Committee hearings. So just once again, is you can't trust authority.
So why do you join the Air Force?
That didn't happen right away. That happened in the late 70s.
It's not that much later.
Well, 79. I had done a number of other things for 4 years after I graduated. I decided that I would join the military for the experience. I wanted to see what it was like. I knew I wasn't going to make it a career, and I didn't. I did not actually make the military a career, although I served for two enlistments during the Cold War.
There's kind of going back to some of the earlier conversation, there's kind of a double track here. You're a contradictory man in some ways.
That's a fair statement, and we all are.
But you seem to be aware of the dark side of American power
and the human condition, not just American power.
Yet you're fighting, like you say, it's not the country I signed up to defend. Meaning the Bush-Cheney Patriot Act era. But what is the country? I mean, is the country you're fighting for an abstraction, and your actual experience?
The abstraction is
something else.
The abstraction is the Constitution. Now, you're probably the first person that's made that distinction. The abstraction is the piece of paper called the Constitution with a Bill of Rights. It mattered. That's the thing that mattered. As a U.S. citizen, that's what mattered. And so I did not take that oath lightly to support and defend it against all enemies, foreign and domestic. What I didn't imagine is that I would find myself face to face in secret with my own government.
That would be the enemy.
That the enemy would become, but then I would be turned into an enemy of the state by virtue of holding up the mirror and speaking truth to enough power.
In your eyes, the state is actually the enemy of the Constitution.
Actually, yes. The whole time, all I was doing was standing on it, defending it, against my own government. Now, if they're going to set aside the Constitution, then what does that mean for our form of governance as a people? I could make a very powerful argument as more than a passing student of history and politics, even having majored and minored in national security and history and government, right, and international relations with my first master's. I can make a very powerful argument that without a Constitution, we're not America. And if we're not America, then we're not, then who we are as Americans.
And you can also make a powerful argument that more or less the Constitution is suspended in real terms at the establishment of the National Security State.
Actually, yes.
Back in the 40s.
It was became subordinate.
And the conditions created by McCarthyism, House of Un-American Activities Committee.
That is the basis for, remember, 9/11 didn't just happen. The suspension of the Constitution that took place in secret after 9/11, for all intents and purposes, didn't just happen because of 9/11. They had already been suspending major parts of it in secret, executive orders, regulations, other statutes, and oftentimes in cooperation with the Congress since 1947.
I mean, Watergate went public, but you don't do that kind of stuff unless you can do that, think you can do that kind of stuff.
But remember that, but see, it's critical to understand me that was my civic awakening. Even the president was not above the law.
Our entire focus should be on the great issues of peace abroad and prosperity without inflation at home. Therefore, I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow. Vice President Ford will be sworn in as president at that hour in this office.
Even the president could lose his very office for violating the special oath that he took to preserve, protect, and defend.
But he got caught in such a public way that it starts to reveal the way that dark deep state works.
Yes.
So he has to be thrown under the bus.
He effectively was, and I think it was a historical mistake for Ford to pardon him. I think he should have actually been put on trial.
Well, that really would have opened up a can of worms.
But Cheney was a critical player in ensuring that Ford pardoned Nixon.
What's that story?
He's chief of staff. Youngest chief of staff, already had his first heart attack. And, you know, we got to preserve the presidency for the future. He had said, if people actually go back and listen to Cheney in some years after that, he said, if I ever find myself in a position, I'm going to essentially restore what was lost as a result of the Nixon administration. Because he always thought that Nixon got a raw deal.
This is the idea of the imperial presidency.
Yeah. And that's a very powerful argument. It's extremely appealing. It's very seductive, especially in crisis. Doesn't matter if the government was part of it. Doesn't matter if the government didn't prevent the crisis. The fact that there is a crisis allows authoritarianism and autocracy to assert itself.
It's a little bit of a distraction from talking about your history, but I've always thought, especially now, although they're not new, but these kind of television shows like Scandal, I guess to some extent 24, there's a whole range of them now, which is kind of all about this dark, deep state, and it's public, it's entertainment programming. It kind of makes it all really acceptable.
Yes, it does. Normalizes it, actually. Makes it rather banal, to be quite frank about it. Just in the background. It all happens, so should be no surprises. It's not just entertainment, though. But hey, we're the elite, we're the ones in charge. You know, as Bush said after 9/11, go to the mall, shop. Don't mourn, shop.
That's
interesting
that
response,
would be your patriotic duty.
Patriotic duty was to continue to be a consumer in the economy. Just be a consumer. You'll be happy.
So, you joined the Air Force. What year did you join?
1979.
You're in for how long?
A little over 9 years.
9 years?
Two enlistments. Then I worked at the CIA for a short time as an imagery analyst.
So I'm going to keep coming back to this, because you're already... A lot of your Americanism has been disillusioned. You've made the point of Watergate growing up in that Nixon era. I keep asking the same question, I'm sorry, but why do you...
The Americanism was worth defending until you can no longer defend it. That moment of truth for me, interesting enough, was actually in secret the first week in October of 2001. that's when you can say I was radicalized by the truth of Pandora's box.
And that was?
Well, as you use the phrase you put, right, in terms of the Constitution. So the for all intents and purposes, I'm eyewitness to suspension of the Constitution.
And that's the institution of mass surveillance.
The mass surveillance regime in particular, knowing it was unleashed in an extraordinary way across the United States and rapidly metastasized. I was eyewitness to all of that. And I reported all of that to the 9/11, the congressional 9/11 investigations, particularly the joint inquiry, all censored and suppressed.
Not a word in the final report.
The only evidence anybody can find to date after almost 13 years is that I was interviewed.
Now, there's two. There's 9/11 Commission, there's a joint congressional investigation.
The JIC, yeah.
Which one are we talking about?
The joint inquiry, the congressional, with the House Intel and Senate Intel committees.
Bob Graham, who was referred to earlier.
That's right. I was never actually interviewed for the 9/11 Commission.
Why?
Because I think my testimony was so explosive, it was smoking gun evidence of NSA's culpability.
Yeah, just to remind people, we talked about this in an earlier segment, that the NSA actually had eavesdropping hard evidence of the connection between these guys, two guys that end up on the American Airlines flight in San Diego, and what was known as a Yemeni switchboard for Al-Qaeda. And I'm sure much more than that.
Actually, far more. That was just one part of it. There was actually an entire intelligence report that they had done prior to months and months. It was actually in early 2001 that NSA refused to allow it to go out for distribution to the rest of the community. And the analysts were beside themselves. I didn't find out about it until shortly after 9/11 when it was brought to me.
What was in it?
The entire network that we knew at that time based on signals intelligence.
The entire network that winds up
Al-Qaeda
doing
and associated
the
9/11 movement, yes. Not every single hijacker, but most of them were known. Yes.
Well, I got to return to something we talked about earlier. There's a back channel to Cheney. You can't sit on this stuff.
Of course not.
Well, watch the earlier
That's
segment.
That's the other intelligence.
We talked about this.
That was the other intelligence network. He couldn't trust what was set up from 1947 on. This is one of the ironies of history. Cheney himself could not trust the early alert and warning system that had put into place in 1947 in which we would never have another electronic Pearl Harbor.
Unless you want one.
Well, he knew it would take something like that. We're going to put it right on the table again because we keep saying it. He knew it would take something like a 9/11 in the 21st century for Americans to just cede to the government whatever was necessary to deal with whatever happened.
To give this...
Pearl Harbor did for us, for our entry into World War II, what 9/11 did in terms of what was unleashed in secret. That included mass surveillance, that included the torture regime.
Now,
and everything else.
The political leadership of both parties, as we keep hearing from various people, including Cheney and Hayden, they're all briefed into all this.
Yes.
So both parties' leadership, they all know this is going on.
Yes, and on the House Intel Committee, Porter Goss and Nancy Pelosi were briefed in at a high level in terms of what was happening. That's why, remember what she said, you know, impeachment was taken off the table. She herself said that. I should tell you something. Although he clearly had violated his own oath, clearly had committed acts that rise to the level of impeachment.
Bush.
Yes. But national security was the protecting mechanism. Now, he was doing it for the good of the nation.
Now, I go back to kind of what is it about people like you, and I'd include in some ways, he didn't suffer the consequences you did, but even a Bob Graham. I mean, Bob Graham's head of the Senate Foreign Intelligence Committee. I mean, he could keep his mouth shut, go back to Florida, have a comfy life.
Most do.
Most do. He didn't have to write a book calling for Bush's impeachment.
But he did.
So what is it about you guys that just
You grow a conscience or you had one? You're also staring at history. You know, remember, way I have put it, I'll say it a different way. You open up Pandora's box, which happened to me. The Pandora's box has opened up, and I'm staring into it, and the abyss is staring back at me. You could close Pandora's box or just look away and act as if nothing was different, because you didn't give the orders, you weren't the authorizer, you didn't make all the decisions.
And that's how Germany gets to a Hitler, and that's how various places get to police states. And
interesting you say it that way. That's why I'm burdened by history. Remember, I am burdened by the dark chapters of the 20th century. I'm burdened by my own father's history from World War II. I'm burdened by what happened during the Cold War. I'm burdened by having listened in for years and years and years on the East German surveillance and police state. You can imagine what it meant in those days, weeks, and months after 9/11, confronted on a far vaster scale. The United States was using the Stasi playbook to put place in secret a mass surveillance regime, which later became known as the collect it all justification from General Alexander. Collect it all? We just need it all. They told me that in early October. We just need the data. We just need the data. Doesn't matter how we get it, doesn't matter where it comes from, we just need the data. So in some ways, it was sort of the pathological response. We did fail, can't admit we failed. We're using it as a convenient excuse to suspend the Constitution, Fourth Amendment, and guess what? We get to unleash all these powers. But we have, just in case, because we quote unquote missed the data, right? And I say that in quotes, we just gotta get all the data.
Okay, in the next
As if that's the answer, which actually makes it worse. You're actually creating greater insecurity, not more security.
Well, that's what we're going to talk about in the next segment. Please join us for the continuation of our interview with Thomas Drake on Reality Asserts Itself on the Real News Network.
Okay, now, I want to remind everybody that there are, well, if you were not of high school age when 9/11 happened, then you had very little chance of actually understanding what was going on. I mean, all you get was the official story, and more so even now. I mean, consider people that were born right on 9/11. They're 15 years old now, just entering high school, first year, second year of high school, whatever. And what's the story they're being told? That 19 Arabs attacked, and that we have to go and retaliate, and all the stuff that's going on now is a result of that, of us resisting that horrible attack. And it's all lies. So you need to get all the young people you know to watch this show and do some homework. Go to YouTube and look up 251 Omega, and you'll get all of these back issues. See you next week.